Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents The Dreamweaver Series. Nightshade by Helen Harper, narrated by Ruth Urquhart. Chapter 1. You have to have a dream so you can get up in the morning. Billy Wilder.
There's a famous Chinese curse that states, "May you live in interesting times." I didn't understand it when I was younger. Back then, I was all about living for the moment, attacking each second as if it were my last, and sucking the marrow out of life, as Robin Williams' character in Dead Poets Society would say. But then, as I experienced more of life, more of other people, more of the world, more of simply being, that is when I truly understood. The Holocaust was interesting times. I also have no doubt that those brave soldiers going over the edge and into the horror of no man's land in World War I didn't pause to think that they were lucky because their lives were not dulled by the tedium of slippers, cigars and armchairs filled with lazy, fat, purring cats. I'd also be surprised if there were any Americans who thought on September the 11th, 2001, well, if only my life was more exciting. My true epiphany, when I really worked out how utterly cool boredom can be, was when I was around 15 years old and had the opportunity to watch paint dry. People pay vast amounts of money to achieve that kind of meditative experience in India, Nepal and Thailand. I achieved this feat without even leaving my bedroom. My parents had allowed me to choose my own paint. Instead of the baby pink that I'd grown up with, I was finally being given the freedom to design my room the way I wanted. And I wanted black. Black to match my heart, my adolescent angst, and my need to be different. Of course, it didn't occur to me at the time that I was playing into the biggest teenage cliche in the book. But hey, I was happy, so it didn't matter. It took me the better part of the morning to cover every section of the room carefully and leave no streaks. Black, as it turns out, is a particularly tricky colour to get right. Anyway, once I was done with the final difficult-to-reach corner, I sat cross-legged on the floor and began to watch. The first hour was the hardest. It was incredibly tempting to reach forward and touch the paint to see how dry it was. I managed to resist the urge. I also didn't want to start shifting around uncomfortably. I was on a mission that didn't involve what my legs felt like or how quickly I could achieve pins and needles. I wanted to watch paint dry. When you pause and take in the world around you, and I mean really take it in, it's amazing what you notice. I had always assumed that the walls of my little space were perfectly flat, but they had a personality of their own. There was a slight groove in the corner where the door occasionally banged and scraped whenever I was in a bad mood, and there was a veritable atlas of bumps, notches and scrapes that even the thick black paint couldn't hide. There was a particularly fascinating dark area that was shaped like my English teacher's head. You'd imagine that you couldn't spot a dark spot on black paint, but it just goes to show that nothing can ever be truly covered up. There's a lesson in that somewhere. Anyway, I focused on that splodge for at least 40 minutes. For weeks afterwards, I felt like I was being watched. As a result, my English homework was extraordinarily well done for a long time afterwards. At some point, my mother called up the stairs that lunch was ready. I ignored her. If I went off to eat, something might happen whilst I was gone. The patch that was lying in a gleam of sunlight might dry whilst I was away, and that simply would not do. In that one day, despite the hungry belly, the pins and needles, and the ever-watchful gaze of Mrs. Humphrey's splodge, I learned that boredom can be fun, that you can always find beauty in the details, no matter how small, and that sometimes we need to take a break and appreciate the world. Excitement is a matter of opinion. I start every day the same. I have my routine off pat, and if Mrs. Humphreys could see me now, she'd be impressed. Well, she would be with the routine part. When I finally realised what was happening and what I had to do to avoid sliding into a spiral of never-ending despair, I decided to be strict with myself. It was the only way I could avoid staying up till goodness knows when, watching dodgy late-night television and reading pointless articles on the internet before collapsing into a coma. Then I'd stay in bed until after 3, if I managed to extricate myself from my duvet at all. That way lies madness. I know what I'm like if I don't keep a handle on my life. My alarm goes off at 6:24 a.m. I allow myself to hit the snooze button once, so when it rings for a second time, it's bang on 6:30. The chairman doesn't enjoy my extra doze, even though he should be used to it by now. The moment my first alarm peals into the dark silence of my bedroom, he hops up next to my pillow and stares down at me, occasionally pawing at my face. I'm often tempted to forego the clock and see what he does next, but habit is something I must maintain. I brush my teeth, shower, get dressed, and put on makeup. I know that it's ridiculous to spend time and money on mascara and foundation when almost no one sees me, but they help me to feel normal. Normal is important. I feed the chairman, who by this time is biting my toes to get me to move faster. Then I eat my own breakfast. It's usually fruit, or maybe a bowl of muesli if I'm feeling unusually hungry. I watch my diet. Junk food is something else I've trained myself to avoid. That was easier than I expected. I drink chamomile tea. No, it doesn't make me any calmer, but I have to try. Check the news and my email. By 8 o'clock, I've started work. I enjoy the mundanity of my existence. There are no surprises. I can take the time to appreciate subtleties, such as how one day my boss, Jerry, will sign off his email with warm regards, which gives me an odd fuzzy feeling, despite its formality. The next day he might simply use regards, and then I wonder if the new baby kept him up the previous night and he's feeling grouchy. When he's in a particularly genial mood, he uses cheers. And today, because he's asking for more than my contract generally allows, he's used high five from down low. I wrinkle my nose. I generally don't enjoy cheese. Still, the task is vaguely interesting, sorting out bugs on a website a different contractor created, so I get down to it. By mid-morning, when the doorbell rings and the familiar terror attacks me, I've made considerable inroads. When I say familiar terror, it really is that. Anyone who's ever felt frightened will recognise the symptoms. The hairs on my arms stand up and my heart starts to quicken. I push back from the desk, gripping the arms of my ergonomically designed and vastly overpriced chair. My breaths are already fast and shallow, so I peel one hand away from the armrest and place it above my belly button, reminding myself to exhale. When I hear the voice calling from outside, my shoulders sag in relief. It's only my mother. Cooey! I'm tempted, as always, not to answer, but I can't pretend that I'm out. She'd just get worried and do something stupid like call the police. She did that once before, in the early days when I refused to get out of bed. I spent the next 5 hours in my wardrobe and was only coaxed out when they threatened to section me. You'd think that would make her less likely to involve the police again, but logic's not my mother's strong point. Not that I have it in spades either. I sigh and stand up. I have special coping mechanisms for the times I need to open the front door. I ignore the rising nausea and lightly pinch the tip of each finger, alternating hands. Then I slowly walk out. I brace my palms on the walls of my narrow hallway to remind myself of their solidity. Fortunately, I already know who's on the other side, so I don't get lightheaded. It's a small victory, but one I still celebrate internally. Baby steps. My front door takes a long time to open. It's steel reinforced and has 5 separate locks. Frankly, if the inheritance I received from my grandfather had allowed, I would have gone the whole hog and ordered a retinal scanner too. Just because I live in a quiet cul-de-sac in a small Scottish town doesn't mean I shouldn't take security seriously. When I finally open the door, I keep the chain on. There's a spy hole, but it doesn't provide a clear path of vision because of the large oak tree in the front garden. I double-check there's no one other than my exasperated-looking mother waiting on the doorstep before I unfasten the chain. I can see the chairman rolling around in a bolt of sunshine behind her. He has a special collar that allows him, and only him, through the cat flap. He blinks at me lazily, and I smile.
Zoe, for heaven's sake, is all this really necessary?
My smile vanishes, and I roll my eyes. The door was installed 16 months ago. My mother visits at least once a week, and she still goes on about it. At least she stopped asking for a key. It's not that I don't trust her, but as I have carefully explained many times, if her bag was lost or stolen, anyone could get into my house.
I wasn't expecting you today, I tell her sternly. Well, she answers, pushing past me, I agreed to join Madge and her cronies for bridge tomorrow, so I can't come as I promised. Is bridge really a good idea after last time? I start to lock the door again. I'd had too much gin then, she dismisses. Reaching up for the highest lock, I'm glad she can't see the expression on my face. And this time you're going to stay off the booze. Don't be ridiculous, darling. But gin makes me silly. I'll have Pim's instead. I turn round. She's observing me with a mixture of fondness and despair. I can't blame her, really. What happens if there's a fire? She asks. Mum, I'm being serious. You'll never get out in a hurry. I'm very careful, as you well know. She snorts. You're 25 years old. You're not supposed to be careful. You're supposed to have fun. I am having fun. I don't look at her as I say this. I don't have to. We could try the doctor again. I've seen enough doctors. I remain stubborn. Besides, few of them make house calls these days. Madge's son has a friend from university who's a psychiatrist. I grip my teeth. My condition is not a secret, but I still get wound up when it's obvious she's been discussing me. She spoke to Madge. Madge spoke to her son. Her son spoke to his mates. I know I'm a weirdo. I don't need the rest of the world to know it too. Okay, my mother means well, but I've been down this road before, and not just once. I've accepted my life with what I believe is impressive equilibrium. I wish everyone else would do the same. Would you like a cup of tea? I manage. I'm not staying. I have an appointment at the hairdresser's. She eyes my home-hacked mob, but thankfully doesn't comment. I just wanted to make sure you're okay. Do you need anything? I soften. She goes out of her way to look after me, and it can't be easy having a hermit for a daughter. No, I had a delivery yesterday. She waggles her eyebrows. It's a feat I've tried to replicate many times in the mirror, but I can't manage the same moo of distaste that she conveys. You were lucky you were born at the right time for the internet. You never need to leave the house. I offer a small smile. No, I don't. And that's why you should stop worrying about me. What else would I do? She reaches over and pecks me on the cheek. Her breath smells of peppermint, and she's wearing a different perfume. Mother? What? She blinks innocently. Are you meeting Mr. McIntyre later? What if I am? I put my hands on my hips. He's married. Henry is a good friend. Is that what you call it these days? You would like him if you met him. I can bring him round, you know. Her eyes gleam. Then you'll be sure there's no hanky-panky taking place. Don't you dare. I hate having strangers in the house. She gazes at me thoughtfully and taps the corner of her mouth. Tell you what, I won't bring him round if you leave the door unlocked after I leave. Not for long, she adds hastily, forestalling my protest. Say, just an hour or two. You're being ridiculous. Am I? Her expression is steely. I can't help wondering whether this was her motive in popping round. The trouble is, I know her well enough to be aware that she'll make good on her threat if I don't do as she asks. I can't lie to her either. Ever since the time I ate all the chocolate chip cookies and blamed it on the dog, she's been able to wheedle out any untruths. That's not fair, I say quietly. You know how hard it is for me. I know. Just an hour, darling. She twists her hands together, and I realise how much she needs this. It will put me on high alert and induce back-breaking tension, but my mother needs to feel I'm making progress. Blood starts pounding in my ears. I do my best to ignore it. Okay. 1 hour. She's relieved. Thank you. You'll see, Zoe. Nothing bad will happen. You're not going outside. You're not going to be in any danger. You're just not locking the door. That's all. She gives me a tight, warm hug. My arms feel leaden, but I reciprocate. Are you going to let me escape from Alcatraz? She asks lightly. I nod, moving my body to block the sight of my shaking hands. She's trying to protect me from me, and I'm trying to protect her from me too. It's farcical. When she's gone and I've closed the door after her, I touch each lock lightly. The desire to slam each one closed is overwhelming, but I batten down the urge and back away. Instead of returning to my little study and my work, however, I sit on the stairs and watch the door. I'm worried I'll hyperventilate. It's happened before. But if I put my head down between my knees to calm myself, then I won't be looking at the door. Someone might come in. Someone might hurt me. I know it's illogical. I'm hardly in the crime capital of the world. I keep a close eye on the outside world, and the last publicised local crime that wasn't white-collar involved a hit-and-run near the town square. That's hardly about to happen to me. None of this is to do with logic, though. Fear is rarely so pragmatic. Some people probably imagine my agoraphobia is a result of a trauma, a brutal rape, or maybe a mugging that landed me in hospital. Perhaps it didn't happen to me and I simply witnessed it. The sad truth is that nothing happened. I wasn't hurt, and I haven't been traumatised by any particular event. Other than a few minor schoolyard skirmishes, I've never been attacked. My life has never been in danger. I simply went to bed as a happy 23-year-old with a nice boyfriend, a wedding on the horizon, a good job and lots of friends, and woke up on my 24th birthday, unable to step outside my front door. I knew that if I did, I'd die. I have no idea where the thought came from, but it was, and still is, a deep certainty that is rooted in my core. Adam, my boyfriend, tried to understand, but things got worse. My condition was exacerbated by three well-meaning friends who, in some amateur attempt at aversion therapy, tried to push me out of the door. That was when I retreated to my bedroom and refused to leave my bed. Adam eventually gave up. Not that I blame him. Who wants a girlfriend who is afraid to go outside? In the end, it was a blessing when he stopped coming around. I still have a few friends who visit occasionally, but I can tell they don't really want to. It's not that they don't like me, they just don't know what to say. They start telling me about work, or a party, or a new shop, and then falter when they realise I can't experience those things. They're so awkward around me that I no longer encourage the friendships. It's just not fair on them. So, it's probably a good thing that I enjoy the silence and detailed beauty of boredom. I'm not sure how long I sit on the uncomfortable step. It feels like an eternity, but I've experienced enough within these four walls to know that what feels like hours may only be a few minutes. As anyone who's been in an accident will tell you, terror slows time down, or maybe it's just the adrenaline. I don't wear a watch because I don't mark minutes, so when my phone starts ringing in the study, I don't know how much time has passed. I stare at the front door, then the study, then back again. By the fifth ring, I manage to stand up. I catch the phone just in time, answering it as I return to the hall and my vigil. Hello?
Zoe, how are you?
Jerry's voice is warm. Good. He doesn't really want to know. With Jerry, as with many other people, how are you is nothing more than a formality. It's funny how I never noticed that until I became housebound.
The website? Have you gotten anywhere yet?
I feel guilty. I should be working. I'm getting there, I say quickly, but I'll need more time.
This client is rather anxious. Do you think you'll manage it by tomorrow?
I make a few quick calculations. It should be possible. I can't risk letting Jerry down, so I no longer have to worry about stopping my mother's little test, even if it's not yet been a full hour. I have bills to pay, after all. I can do that, he exhales loudly.
Super. I knew we could count on you.
It's what I'm here for.
You're a trooper.
A super trooper. He doesn't register my little sarky comment, merely responds with warm agreement.
Absolutely.
I say goodbye and hang up. Lowest form of wit, Zoe, I mutter. Jerry is a good guy. He doesn't deserve my snide remarks. I've learned to be content with my existence, but I sometimes wonder if my enforced isolation has made me lose my good manners. At least he wasn't offended. I gaze at the door again, my eyes travelling over its familiar veneer. There are a few scratches on the bottom panel where the chairman sharpened his claws once or twice. I run my fingers over them before pressing my ear against the wood. Other than the chirping of a few mating birds, I can't hear anything. Maybe it wouldn't do any harm to leave it unlocked for another 15 minutes while I return to bites and coding.
I curl my fingers into my palms until they hurt. My stomach is fluttery, but I know my body well enough, and I still have some way to go before a full-blown panic attack sets in. I think of the expression on my mother's face when I tell her I managed to sit out of view of the door. 15 minutes is only 900 seconds. That's not long. It would take far less than that for someone to come inside and attack me, though. I glance at the wall, imagining its pristine white splattered with my blood, and I shiver. I can't do it. I am tugging at the first lock to slide it shut, when there's a knock. Actually, knock is the wrong word. It's a frantic staccato, rising in intensity. I fall backwards, my veins twisting into ice. My breathing abruptly changes, and my chest rises and falls alarmingly.
Help me!
It's a male voice, and despite the muffled quality thanks to the closed door, it's obviously full of panic. I shake my head rapidly. I'm imagining things. I have to be imagining things. But the door rattles, and the knocking continues. I'm frozen to the spot. My eyes are fixed on the door handle. I will myself to lurch forward and lock it, but my brain won't send the right signals to my legs. My throat feels tight, and pins and needles tingle up and down my arms. I can feel the sweat on my skin, and my vision starts to swim. No, not now. The door handle jerks downwards. I can't do anything except stare in horror as the door crashes open and a figure appears. His face is red and his eyes are bulging. He lunges towards me and I scramble back. He's going to grab my ankle, though. He must have a weapon. It's only a matter of moments and he'll... I blink several times. He's not reaching out towards me at all. He's face down and twitching. His hair is snow white and very thin, and his hands, clawing the carpet, are wrinkled and old. Move, I tell myself. My heart thuds, but my breathing is slowing. The man's feet hang lifelessly out of my porch. He's wearing tartan slippers, and I focus on them. Move, Zoe, move. I make it to his side and turn him over. He gulps for air. His skin is no longer merely red. It's purple. One hand flails towards his chest, and I realise what is happening. My panic fades, to be replaced by an even more alarming sensation that I can't yet name. You're having a heart attack. My voice is weak and shaky, and I have no idea whether the man heard me. Recovery position, I mutter. I'm going to put you in the recovery position. Stay calm. I don't know whether I'm telling him or myself. He chokes, and I can see red threads lining the whites of his eyes. I adjust his right leg and manoeuvre his heavy body. His arms thrash, making it difficult for me to move them. He grunts something. Don't talk, I say. I try again to move him into the correct position, but he has more strength than I'd have thought possible, and he fights me. I remember the phone. It was in my hand when he started knocking, and I must have dropped it. I search frantically, finally locating it under his back. I did say logic isn't my strong suit. The sensible thing would have been to call the police immediately I saw the man. Instead, I let the panic destroy any semblance of common sense, and now, if I don't get help in the next few minutes, this man is going to die. I jab in the number and wait for someone to answer.
999, what's your emergency?
I'm at 17 Christie Crescent. There's a man. I think he's having a heart attack.
What's your name?
Zoe. Zoe Lydon.
Zoe, I need you to stay calm. I'm dispatching an ambulance right now.
Please tell them to hurry.
They will.
The voice is soothing and calm, but it's not helping. What do I do? I shriek. What do I do?
Is he still breathing?
Yes.
You need to keep his airway clear. Put him in the recovery position. That's...
I drop the phone. The woman's voice continues, disembodied, but I refocus my efforts on moving the man into place. He's losing strength. His arms are easier to manoeuvre now. He doesn't have much time. He grunts again.
The department.
Shh, I say. Help is on its way. Don't talk. They'll be here soon. I can already hear the distant sirens. He twists onto his back and his right hand clutches at my blouse, pulling me down.
Don't trust them.
Sir, I begin as his left hand reaches up. He presses it hard against my chest and I feel a funny jolt like an electric shock or something, sending prickles down through my body. Then his arms collapse onto the floor and his eyes roll back into his head. The sirens get louder and louder while I begin CPR.
Chapter 2. All men dream, but not equally. T. E. Lawrence.
It all happens so fast. When the paramedics lift his body and take it away, I'm still in a daze. By rights, I should be huddled in a corner and whimpering, or back within the safety of my wardrobe, but somehow the events have overtaken my natural urges. That's not to say I'm not in a state of horrified disbelief, however.
Did you know him?
The young policeman who arrives sometime after the ambulance asks. I stare at him, slack-jawed. The words make sense individually, but as a whole, they flummox me. He repeats the question.
No. I've never seen him before in my life.
He seems concerned.
You should go to the hospital, Miss Lydon. You might be experiencing mild shock.
Compared to my normal state, it's a miracle how I'm handling things. I look him over. He has kind eyes, and he's obviously keen to help. He reaches out, his fingers brushing against my arm, and I flinch. He drops his hand immediately, while my mind flashes back to the wooden walls of my wardrobe. In the past hour, I've had more strangers in my narrow little hallway than in the last year.
Please go, I whisper.
He's confused. He opens his mouth to speak, but a pale hand appears from the sunny outside world and gently touches his shoulder. I register a familiar face gazing at me with pity. My jelly-like insides start to harden.
Miss Lydon,
the policewoman says politely,
it's good to see you again.
I realise that she's been here before. That's why I recognise her. This is a small town, so it should be no surprise. In fact, the only surprise is that her colleague hasn't heard of me. The batty woman who refuses to go outside. I can imagine I'm a source of amusement down at the small police station.
Would you like me to call your mother?
She asks. Desperation claws at me, and I just manage to prevent myself from whimpering yes. I steel myself. The worst is over. I can cope on my own. I shake my head.
You know, we'll need to come back and ask you more questions, once we've established more about the victim, that is.
Okay.
We'll call ahead so you have advance warning. I can call the surgery and have a doctor.
No!
I'm taken aback by the strength in my voice. I straighten my shoulders and look her in the eye.
I'm fine.
Her lips tighten at my tone, but she's professional enough to refrain from commenting further. She nods, gesturing to her partner, who seems completely baffled by the interplay. Like a good boy, he does what he's told and leaves. I slam the door shut behind them, fumbling with the locks as I peer at their departing backs through the spy hole. The policeman bows his head, obviously listening to her explanation.
Don't worry about Zoe Lydon,
I say, mimicking her clipped voice. She's just cuckoo. We should be thankful she stays off the streets. She probably murdered that old guy because he came round for a cup of sugar. I pause for a moment, my eyes widening. Maybe they'll actually think that. I gnaw at the inside of my cheek. He had a heart attack. I couldn't have caused that. But my worry refuses to subside. The policeman jerks his head back in my direction and I stumble away from the door. Then my legs give out and I collapse onto the carpet. Eventually, I get my hiccuping sobs under control. I smooth my trembling hands over my trousers several times before clenching and unclenching my fists. My heartbeat races and I think of the strange electric shock the old man gave me. It felt more powerful than static and I wonder if it had something to do with his heart attack. It's a ridiculous notion, of course. Heart attacks aren't contagious. Perhaps it was psychosomatic. I rub my chest. Whatever it was, it's gone now, just like the old man. His slack jaw and unseeing eyes are seared into my memory. His poor family. He had to be visiting one of my neighbours. I make a point of knowing who lives around me, and he wasn't one of them. There was nothing I could have done. The thought doesn't help me feel any better. I return to the door and check the spy hole again. Both the path and the pavement are clear. Even the chairman has vanished. I check each lock, tugging hard at the door. It rattles against the frame, but it seems secure. Satisfied, I start moving around the house, testing each window. During the day, I'm not too stressed about the windows, because most of them don't open widely, so it would take anyone larger than a child a long time to squeeze through. As long as I'm conscious, it would be impossible for an intruder to get in without me noticing. I avoid having them open, of course. Right now, they're all tightly closed. Finally, I go into the kitchen and let the tap run until it's icy cold. I splash water on my face and dab my wrists. I strain my ears, but beyond the distant hum of traffic and the occasional bark from the Labrador at number 25, everything sounds normal. Normal. A man just collapsed in my house and died in front of me. How normal is that? I sit down at my desk, my eyes following the screensaver as it bounces from edge to edge. It seems crazy to go back to work after what's just happened, but I don't know what else to do, and it might distract me. I wish for a moment that I knew the man's name. It would give him more dignity if I could stop thinking of him as the old man who died in my hallway. I wonder about his tartan slippers and his harsh whisper of caution about the mysterious department. Maybe he was suffering from Alzheimer's. He could have been confused and wandered away from his carer and ended up at my door. If that were true, maybe his passing is a relief to him and those who loved him. And the police will close the book on the case without dragging me away for interrogation. I shudder. No, work will definitely help. Several hours later, my neck and back are aching. My soul still feels heavy, but my earlier panic has all but subsided. I send Jerry a quick email, informing him that I finished ahead of schedule. He'll have left the office already. It's been dark outside for some time, but like many people these days, he'll still read the email and respond. I massage my weary muscles, realizing that I'm very hungry. Not surprisingly, I'd skipped lunch, and the last thing I'd had through the afternoon was an appetite. I guess normal service is resuming. I walk into the hall and stare down at the patch of carpet where the old man breathed his last. "I'm sorry," I say softly. I'm not sure whether I'm talking to myself or to the old man's departed spirit, and my voice echoes emptily as if to emphasise how paltry my offering is. I blink away tears and head to the kitchen to prepare some food. I sit in my usual spot at the table, my ankles curled around the chair legs. I carefully chew each mouthful of my omelette. The large clock on the wall ticks away. I clear my plate before carefully washing it, along with my knife and fork and the frying pan. Once I'm done, I allow myself to turn on the radio. I want to hear the local news in case the old man is mentioned. I endure the DJ gabbling about an upcoming dance festival that's going to attract hundreds of people of all ages and from all walks of life. I sigh, although in the past I've not been beyond turning up the music and dancing around the living room on my own as if to recreate the same effect. When the news finally comes on, there's no mention of the man. I give up and move to the living room, settling back into the plump cushions with a book. At some point, the chairman joins me, deigning for once to settle on my lap with a deep, throaty purr. The pages blur, and I find it difficult to concentrate. After reading the same paragraph 5 times, I set the book aside and close my eyes. Enough already. It's the prickle along the top of my ears that alerts me to the fact that something is different. I snap open my eyes. What on earth? I'm on a cobbled street, streaks of orange light bouncing off the puddles. There's a steady stream of drizzle, and without consciously doing it, I lift my face, enjoying the damp splashes on my skin. I wait for the screaming panic to start, but there's nothing. Curious. I don't feel afraid. Neither do I feel cold. There's not a breath of wind. In fact, there's no sound whatsoever, which makes as little sense as my lack of fear. It doesn't matter where you are, whether it's in the country or the city or at the top of Mount Everest, there are always sounds. Even soundproofed rooms have a certain quality to them that suggests, well, sound. Here, there's nothing. The effect isn't frightening. It's not even unnatural. It's just weird. I look over my shoulder, starting in surprise. There's a wall of black, deep, impenetrable black of the sort I never achieved on the walls of my teenage bedroom. I reach out towards it, feeling an odd tingle as my fingertips brush against it. It has a spongy quality. I press harder, keeping the rest of my body well back from it. It doesn't matter how much effort I make, I can't penetrate it by more than an inch or two. I withdraw my hand and look at it, wiggling each finger in turn. I half expect some strange sticky substance to linger there, but my skin is clean. I frown, then shrug. In the absence of anything better to do, I leave the strange wall behind and start walking. My feet don't make a sound. I stop next to a large puddle. Experimentally, I kick at it, sending a spray of water arcing upwards. Everything is still silent. I take a deep breath and jump in, shocked when my legs plunge downwards. For a moment, my stomach leaps sickeningly into my throat until my toes touch the bottom. The puddle is deep enough to reach my chest. I laugh, and the sound is so unexpected, it reverberates around the strange street. I lift up my arms and crash them down, creating a mini tsunami, then bob there, marvelling at what I'm experiencing. I'd thrown a few mushrooms into the pan when I made my omelette. They looked normal enough, and the large supermarket chain I'd ordered them from shouldn't have been selling hallucinogenics, but it's the only thing that makes sense. I giggle at the thought of people up and down the country having similar visions because of dodgy fungi. As soon as I come round, I'll have to order more before the supermarket realises its mistake. This is so much fun. I heave myself out of the puddle. It's surprisingly difficult, and I end up half sprawled on the cobbles like a beached seal. I clamber to my feet, shaking my body to rid myself of the worst of the water, and start walking again. Well, I say walking, it's more of a skip, to be honest. No, I don't advocate drug use, and I really enjoy my boring existence, most of the time anyway. But after the day I've had, this hallucination is taking my mind off the horrors. Besides, it's only a street with a few wacky puddles in it. I start humming a skewed version of Ode to Joy. I'd love an umbrella, because then I could recreate Gene Kelly's dance from Singing in the Rain. I glance down at my empty hands and will an umbrella to appear, but it doesn't work. I wrinkle my nose and shrug. It's no great disaster. I continue, my humming getting louder. The rain continues to fall, the cobbles stretch ahead, and the street remains silent. This really is... Oh, shit. I crash to a halt as I see the figure ahead. For a moment I feel a flicker of fear, but it quickly changes to irritation. This is my hallucination, I think crossly. I'm an agoraphobic with few friends. There shouldn't be anyone here apart from me. I have half a mind to march up to my mushroom-induced interloper and tell them to get out of my street. I square my shoulders and decide to do just that. It's a young woman, wearing a tight red dress and high heels, so impossibly tall, it's a wonder she's not toppling over. She doesn't glance in my direction, even when I'm less than 3 feet away from her. Hey! I say sharply. She still doesn't look at me. Instead, she turns away, and I follow her gaze, my heart sinking when I see another person strolling towards us. I tut like a petulant child.
Hello, drawls the young policeman who tried to help me earlier.
He's speaking to the woman. I do a double take. What is he doing here? Although maybe it makes sense. He did play a major role in my day. It doesn't mean I want him in my head, though. Why couldn't I hallucinate Ryan Gosling? I mutter to myself. Neither the woman nor the policeman seems to hear me. He walks up to her and pushes her against the wall.
I've been waiting for this for so long, he breathes.
The woman's mouth curves into a slow smile. Ali Bear, you're my kind of man. Then just like that, their lips lock together. I cough. Excuse me? His hand reaches down to the hem of her dress and tugs it higher. She moans, pressing into him, and my cheeks flare up in embarrassment. I don't want to see this. Why would I hallucinate this? Do it, she murmurs. No, don't do it.
Only if you beg me, he purrs in response.
I put my hands over my ears and squeeze my eyes shut. No, 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 no. I feel something sharp digging into me and hear a faint but familiar low-pitched growl. I take my hands slowly away from my ears and stare at the chairman. His hackles are fully raised and his pupils are wide and round. He hisses and spits, leaps off my lap and bounds away. I blink several times, shaking myself back into awareness. I'm still in my own living room and in my own chair. I look round.
Everything's the same, although my tongue feels furry and there's a strange metallic taste in my mouth. Maybe I won't go ordering any more mushrooms again after all, I murmur. I uncurl my legs, go to the mirror, and stare at my reflection. I pull up my eyelids and examine my pupils. They look normal enough. Sticking out my tongue, I check for other signs that I've been drugged. Then the thought hits me that maybe someone did something to me today. One of the paramedics, maybe, or that policeman himself. They could have given me something slow-acting, which is why it didn't take effect until now. Something that brushed against my skin. It might be related to the strange electric shock I received from the old man. My heart pounds and my chest tightens. They could have done it to gain access to my home while I was passed out. I race jerkily towards the door, checking every lock again. It's still closed. It would be, though. My potential assailant wouldn't get past it. The windows. Maybe I didn't check them as closely as I thought. I waste no further time and grab the phone with one hand, ready to punch in 999, and a pre-prepared paper bag with the other. Living room. Windows all closed. Kitchen. Closed. Bathroom. Closed. My throat constricts. Upstairs, then. I stare at the mountain of steps leading up to the first floor. Oh, God. Oh, God. Oh, God. Who's there? I shout hoarsely. There's no response. I'm coming up. I'm armed. I look at the paper bag I'm clutching. That really was a ridiculous thing to say. Barely managing to breathe, I ascend one step, then another, and another. When I reach the landing, the lights are dancing in front of my eyes again, and I know I'm not far from blacking out. I can't let myself. If I do, anything could happen. Bedroom one, closed. Bedroom two, windows still all closed. Utility cupboard, empty. Bathroom. I stretch out for the cold metal doorknob and start to twist. My breaths are so loud that I can't hear anything else. Whoever's on the other side of that door could be shouting, and I wouldn't hear them. I clench my teeth and throw it open. A pair of dark, frightened eyes stares back at me from the bathroom mirror. Me. There's no one there after all. My face is pale, and there are dark circles under my eyes, but the contours of my cheekbones and the familiar smattering of freckles across them comforts me. I breathe into the bag, doing what I can to slow my heart rate down, and continue to keep my gaze fixed on my reflection. Something's still not right. I drop the phone and reach one shaky hand up to my long brown hair, which curtains my face in waves. For some reason, it's damp.
Chapter 3. I am interested in imperfections, quirkiness, insanity, unpredictability. That's what we really pay attention to anyway. We don't talk about planes flying. We talk about them crashing. Tibor Kalman. It's not surprising that I don't sleep that night. The chairman also spends most of the wee hours hiding. It's not the first time I've wished he could talk. Perhaps then he could tell me exactly what happened. I get through the night by sitting upright in bed, hugging my knees tightly to my chest. I manage yet again to avoid another full-blown panic attack, but it's still a relief when dawn breaks. When the telephone rings just after 9, it's a welcome distraction.
Miss Lydon, this is Sergeant Rawlins. We met yesterday. I was hoping we could come by again today.
I almost gush down the phone. It's embarrassing. That would be fantastic. Can you come now? If the policewoman is taken aback at my sudden desire to have visitors, she doesn't show it in her voice and merely agrees to come by mid-morning. As soon as I replace the receiver, I'm galvanised into action. I've been scouring the internet, and I can find no trace of anyone experiencing strange post-mushroom-eating hallucinations in the last month. At least not from mainstream supermarket aisle mushrooms. So either a policeman or paramedic used an airborne or skin-to-skin contact pathogen to make me dream like that, or I am going crazy. Frankly, I am more inclined to believe the latter. I may be agoraphobic and extremely paranoid, but that doesn't mean the emergency services of Great Britain are out to get me. I'm not a complete idiot. Unfortunately, if I am going insane, I have no idea how to deal with it. A doctor might want to take me into hospital for evaluation. I might even be locked up in a psychiatric ward.
I don't think that will help me in the slightest. At the moment, the easiest thing to do is to eliminate the police from my amateur inquiries. Why did the young policeman pop up out of nowhere in my dream? Is my subconscious telling me something? I just wish it would speak a little more clearly. I dash upstairs and change, ensuring that I wear a long-sleeved shirt along with a pair of jeans. Officer Sex in the alley touched my arm yesterday, and I was wearing a t-shirt, so he connected with my bare skin. It was nothing more than a brief brush and seemed innocuous enough, but I'm not taking any chances. I even hunt through my underwear drawer to find the long-sleeved gloves I bought for a fancy dress party. It'll look weird, but let's face it, I am weird. Once I'm satisfied with my clothing, I close all the upstairs doors and steel myself to open the ground floor windows. If I'm not nuts and this thing, whatever it is airborne, then I need fresh air to keep everything ventilated.
When the doorbell finally rings, I slowly unbolt each lock. Butterflies squirm in my belly, but I manage to squash them. It's not the two police officers standing on my porch, however. It's the postman. He's a regular visitor and is well aware of my foibles, but there's something dark and furtive about him. Still, while I wouldn't say I feel comfortable when he appears, his presence is not frightening.
"Hello, Zoe," he says, raising his thin eyebrows. "You have a parcel."
He holds it out, and I take it awkwardly, shoving it under my arm. "There's no sign of another letter, is there?" I ask. I've been waiting for my annual missive from HMRC. There's nothing like a tax return for someone who appreciates boredom. He shakes his head.
"Sorry."
He looks like he's about to say something else, but he's interrupted by a car pulling up next to the oak tree. We both look at the police car, and I notice that his body stiffens. When Officer Sex in the alley raises a hand in my direction, the postman grins.
"Been a naughty girl, have we?"
He pats me on the shoulder and winks. I'm annoyed, but I try not to show it. You should never let some people know that they've annoyed you, because they'll do it more often. I think the postman is one of those. I mutter something inane and barely notice his departure because I'm focused on the policeman. His uniform looks normal and he's not carrying anything out of the ordinary. His eyes still look kind. I really must be crazy if I think he's involved in some intricate plot to send me into a drug-induced dream world and throw water on my hair.
"Miss Lydon,"
he calls out cheerily,
"I hope you're all right."
His concern seems genuine. I force a smile.
"Yes."
Sergeant Rawlins joins him on the path. I look from one to the other.
"Come in."
They exchange glances as I step aside. I direct them into the living room, but don't invite them to sit. They do anyway.
"So, Miss Lydon, we normally ask you to make a statement down at the police station, but..."
"But because I'm alone who refuses to step outside, you've been kind enough to come and do it here instead,"
I say dryly. They both look uncomfortable.
"Indeed."
Rawlins laughs awkwardly.
"We just have a few questions."
She waves a recorder in my direction.
"Do you mind?"
I examine the device a little too thoroughly before nodding.
"Sure."
"Have you ever seen the man who collapsed at your door before?"
"No, as I told your colleague."
I smile pointedly at Officer Sex in the alley.
"Sorry, I don't know your name."
He looks embarrassed.
"Hartman, Constable Hartman."
"As I told your colleague, Constable Hartman," I repeat. "I've no idea who he was."
I watch their faces carefully. When both their expressions flicker, I suck in a breath.
"You don't know who he is either, do you?"
Rawlins seems frustrated.
"We've been to all the neighbouring streets and checked with all the residential homes. No one has seen him before."
Panic swirls in the pit of my stomach, and I'd been doing so well up to now.
"He was wearing slippers."
"He may have driven here, or someone dropped him off in the area. We are confident we shall establish his identity soon."
I have no response. I simply stare at them as I try to work through the possibilities.
"Did he say anything?" Rawlins probes.
"He told me not to trust the department."
"What department?"
"I have no idea."
Rawlins frowns.
"Can you think of any reason why he'd come to your door in particular? It's not the easiest to access after all."
I rub my forehead.
"Nothing springs to mind."
I meet her eyes.
"Why did he die?"
"We're waiting on the post-mortem,"
So it may not even have been natural causes. He might have been...
You are letting your imagination run away with you, Miss Lydon, she says, no doubt silently adding crazy lady as an epithet at the end of her sentence.
I give up on her and appeal to Hartman instead. This can't be normal. Elderly people can't just appear from nowhere.
He scratches his neck. It does look a little.
For a moment, Rollin's facade slips.
Alistair!
My mouth drops open. Alistair? That's your name? He smiles at me while Rollins rolls her eyes.
Yeah.
Ali Bear, I whisper.
Hartman freezes. What? What did you say?
I stare at him while he stares at me. Rollins is beyond confused.
I'm not quite sure what's happening here, she begins.
Who calls you that? I interrupt. His neck reddens. He doesn't answer, but I can see enough of the answer in his eyes to tell me that someone does. I feel the walls press in on me. Nothing is making any sense. After they leave, I sink into a chair and press the base of my palms against my temples. I was so flabbergasted by Hartman's reaction to the endearment that I stopped watching his movements so carefully, but I don't think he did anything out of the ordinary. I toy with the parcel the postman gave me, eventually opening it more out of the need for something to do than real curiosity. It's a box of chocolates, sent express delivery by Jerry to thank me for completing yesterday's project. In light of everything that's happened, the website work seems so inconsequential that I barely raise a smile. It has to be a coincidence, I decide. Perhaps Ali Bear is a common pet name. Or maybe I overheard something yesterday that appeared in my hallucination. It could have happened easily enough. A co-worker at the scene might have called him that sarcastically, and I didn't notice because I was in such a state of shock. But that doesn't explain my wet hair or the vividness of the experience. There's only one way to find out. I will have to let myself hallucinate again and see what happens. I have no idea, of course, how I happened to hallucinate in the first place. And was it a hallucination or a dream? After my lack of sleep last night, I'm pretty tired, but not ready to drop off just yet. All I have to do is wait till nighttime, fall asleep, dream of exactly nothing, and forget this ever happened. I twist my fingers in my lap. I'm not sure I can wait that long. I spring up, jog upstairs and into the bathroom. I fling open the cabinet and rummage around until I find what I need. When my fingers curl round the small white bottle, I give a grim smile. Valium. It was prescribed when my agoraphobia started, but after several days it had no visible effects other than helping me fall asleep. It might do the trick now, though. I check the expiration date. They're still usable. I fill a glass of water and down the pills. As I head to my bedroom to lie down, it occurs to me that I should try to recreate last night as closely as possible. I switch direction and tramp downstairs. I pick up the book I'd been reading, find the same paragraph, and settle down in the same chair. After I've read the paragraph again, I put the book to the side and close my eyes. Bring it on, I whisper. The top of my ears prickle, and I open my eyes. I'm immediately disappointed. I'm not in a wet, cobbled street, but in a room, a strange room filled with old-fashioned furniture and flocked wallpaper. For a moment, I wait to be assailed by my own strange terror, but when I remain as fine as I did in the puddle-filled street, I relax and walk over to the mantelpiece to examine the array of ornaments. I pick up a tiny glass elephant and frown. It looks like typical tourist tat. I'm about to replace it when I hear a soft noise from behind. I turn round, and where before there was a bare rug, there is now a single white envelope. The handwritten address on the front keeps moving. The words vanish, then reappear as I watch. Something in the corner of my eye flutters, and I glance up and see another letter floating down. It moves like a feather, buoyed by invisible currents of air, but there's no breeze in here. It lands gently next to the first envelope. I look up at the artex-covered ceiling. There's no gap in it, but still, as I watch, another envelope magically appears. Then there's a postcard, followed in rapid succession by a larger brown letter. I'm transfixed, so it takes me a moment to notice that I'm no longer alone. Somehow,
I'm not surprised by who's with me. Hello, I say cautiously. The postman doesn't hear me. He walks to the middle of the room, avoiding stepping on the letters on the floor. He looks older, with deep lines and furrows on his face. He nudges one of the letters with his toe before letting out an anguished howl. The noise is so unexpected and so filled with pain that I take an involuntary step backwards. Are you all right? He doesn't react, so I move towards him. Nervously, I reach out to touch his shoulder in almost the same place where he patted mine earlier today. He scratches at it absently, but doesn't realise that I'm next to him. Without warning, a sudden flurry of envelopes drop at the postman's feet. Some of them land on his head or careen through the air and hit his face. Every time one connects, a tiny paper cut appears. I back away, watching in horror. Soon, he's surrounded by a puddle of brown and white paper that reaches his ankles, then his knees. I catch sight of something in my peripheral vision, realising too late that it's a sharp-cornered envelope flying in my direction. I duck to avoid it, but I don't move quickly enough. There's a sharp pain as it strikes my cheek. I lift up my fingers and touch the spot. It's bleeding. Despite the pain and blood, I know none of this is real. Everything that's happening is in my head, so even though more and more envelopes start appearing, some whizzing around the room at a dangerous speed, I don't believe I'm in any danger. I know for certain that this is only a dream, but it's an odd experience. I'm out of my comfort zone, but I'm not in the least afraid. Unfortunately, the same cannot be said for the postman. The pile of letters keeps growing, and he is panicking. He struggles, his arms flailing. It looks like he's trying to escape, but his feet won't move. He looks like someone stuck in quicksand. I reach out and try to grab his hand to pull him away, but every time I get near, he yanks it away, clawing at the air. All the while, the envelopes continue to fall. When the pile reaches his stomach, his face grows red as if he's struggling to breathe. The letters swirl around him, fluttering and flying like some strange vortex or cyclone of post. Soon, I can only glimpse flashes of him through the thick cloud of paper. I can certainly hear him, however. He's screaming at the top of his lungs.
It's only a dream!
I shout. He doesn't move. He just goes on screaming.
Wake up! This isn't real!
I can just make out his head turning towards me. I can't tell if he sees me or not, so I rush forward, waving my arms to create a space so I can pull him out. Half a beat later, I'm back in my chair, still throwing my arms wildly in front of me. My heart is thrumming a staccato beat in my chest. It's over. I force myself to be still. Then I get up and walk over to the mirror. My hair is mussed up. I feel a faint throb in my cheek and lean in for a closer look. There's a single bead of blood in the very spot where the envelope struck me. I touch it gingerly. I can't stop worrying about the postman. Surely he's all right. It was all in my head, not his. I gnaw my bottom lip and check the clock. It's 3 a.m. That's when I really freak out, because all the windows on the ground floor are still open, and I've been unconscious for more than 15 hours. It's comfortingly dark in the wardrobe. The old dresses and even older coats that I've not worn in months hang over me like security blankets. The smell is familiar, a tinge of must and flowery fabric softener. In here, I'm safe. I've been counting in my head for hours. When I finally reach 10,000, I know it must be morning. There's something I have to do, and I can't do it from in here, so I will myself to get up. I picture myself doing it, first standing, then pushing open the door and stepping out. I squeeze my eyes shut as I imagine the movements. It's only my bedroom. There's nothing and no one there. I pinch my fingertips together, circling through each one. Before I know it, I'm standing up and ready to move. I ignore the roar of blood in my ears and take a deep breath. Come on, Zoe, I whisper. As silently as I can, I open the wardrobe door a fraction. Light pours in. I blink and open it a little further. I can see my bedspread and part of the far wall. So far, so normal. The chairman is sitting on the edge of the bed, staring at me with his large green eyes. He purrs, stretches and stands up. I give him a small smile. Were you guarding me? I ask. He meows in response, and I scratch him under the chin. I'm sorry, I tell him. I know I promised I wouldn't do that again. He butts his head against me. I sigh. Is talking to your cat a sign of madness? Because dreams that are so vivid they seem real certainly are. I look at the bedside clock. It's later than I thought, and I don't want to miss him. Unless there's another parcel for me, which is unlikely, the postman will simply push any post through the letterbox. If I don't have any letters today, it'll be even harder to get hold of him. I swallow the last vestiges of my fear and go down to the front door. When I don't see anything through the spy hole, I think I'm too late, but barely a minute later, the postman's red van appears around the corner. I start unbolting, leaving only the main lock still fastened. The postman disappears out of view as he leaves the van and goes to the neighbour on my left. I hold my breath, hoping there will be a letter for me today. The prospect of standing on my porch and calling after him is about as appealing as stripping naked and running through the town square with a tea cosy on my head. Fortunately, my luck holds, and he emerges from behind the oak tree and walks down my path. I wait until he's a few feet away before I open the final lock and stick my head out of the door. He's obviously surprised, pausing in mid-step and blinking at me. He recovers quickly, though, and waves a single brown envelope in the air. I feel a flicker of trepidation, but I force myself to focus on his face instead. Rather than the tired visage I saw in my dream, he appears relaxed and more youthful. He's clearly none the worse for wear. I open the door fully and try to stay calm.
Good morning.
I move my mouth into the shape of a smile. How are you?
Fine and dandy.
Did you sleep well?
He gives me a funny look. Yes, thank you. Just the one letter for you today.
No nightmares, I persist.
Nightmares? He scratches his neck. No, I never dream. Why, do I look tired?
I shake my head. You look fine. It's just, I had a bad nightmare last night. About letters.
Oh, yes?
His voice is flat. He's completely uninterested in what I'm saying. It's hardly surprising. Hearing about people's dreams never makes for scintillating conversation unless you're Sigmund Freud. Or me, of course. He passes me the letter, and I spot a sudden crafty light in his eyes.
If you're having bad dreams, though, perhaps I can come round tonight and help you with them.
He licks his lips, stroking his thumb slowly across his jaw. No thanks, I squeak, horrified, and hurriedly step back and slam the door shut. I bolt all the locks, ignoring the sound of him chuckling to himself on the other side of the door. I don't breathe out and relax until I hear his footsteps retreat. I've been clutching the letter so tightly that it's scrunched up. I smooth it out. It's not the long-awaited tax letter, merely some gump from the local council. It doesn't even have my name on it. I sit on the bottom stair, staring thoughtfully at the locked door. As far as the postman is concerned, nothing strange at all happened last night. He seemed to be telling the truth when he said he never dreamt, though laboratory studies have proven that everyone dreams. It's just that 95% of us don't remember them. I touch my cheek. It's still a bit tender, so I've got more than mere memory to help jog my brain into action. I think about the postman's dream. All those letters were drowning him, attacking him. I have a theory. If it's wrong, it proves nothing. But if it's right, I nod my head decisively. It doesn't take long to get hold of Rawlins. I'd thought about contacting Hartman first, but for some reason I trust her brusqueness more than his affability.
Have you remembered something else?
She asks, her voice even more clipped on the phone than it is in person. No, I pause. I'm calling about another matter.
Go on.
I draw in a breath. I know you think I'm nuts, but I need you to hear me out.
I don't think that, Miss Lydon.
I'm sure she does. I let it go, though. I think my postman is hoarding mail, taking the letters and then not delivering them. He's probably keeping them in his house.
She's silent for a moment. If that's the case, she finally begins, you should probably contact Royal Mail.
I'm not making it up. It's a serious matter, you know. People rely on their post. As soon as I say the words, I wonder whether that's true. How much has been replaced by the internet? I don't give up, however.
I think you should check it out.
We can't chase up every...
Please. I keep my voice as level and friendly as I can.
We're really very busy.
You don't think that someone stealing mail is important?
We're investigating a mysterious death, Miss Lydon, or perhaps you'd forgotten that.
I thought, I said softly, that believing he died from anything other than natural causes would be a flight of fancy.
Sergeant Rawlins sighs. I'll look into it, but I can't promise it'll be this week.
That's the best I'm going to get. I withdraw while the going is still good.
Thank you, I tell her. I mean it.
Chapter 4. This whole world is wild at heart and weird on top. David Lynch.
On Wednesday, Constable Hartman touched my arm and I dreamt of him. On Thursday, it was the postman. Today, I've been free from all human contact and I'm expecting a normal night's sleep. So when my ears prickle again, I feel a jolt of shock, even through my unconscious state. This time, I'm in a forest. It's dark and spooky, and unlike the previous two hallucinations, or dreams, or whatever you want to call them, it's cold. There are goosebumps on my arms. I'm wearing the same holy old t-shirt I put on to go to bed. It might reach down to my knees, but it offers scant protection against the frigid air. I wrap my arms around my body and look around my surroundings. Again, I feel normal. Despite my nervousness about where I am, I'm not about to pass out or hyperventilate. The trees are massive. They tower over me, looming and menacing. The canopy above is so dense that I can't make out whether there's a sky. There's certainly no light. I can barely see more than a few feet in front. I shiver and turn round to check behind me. More trees. I step carefully over to the nearest one. I can feel sticks and stones underneath my bare feet, so I rise onto my toes to avoid splinters or cuts. Then I frown. If I ended up with a splinter here, would it exist back in the real world? I mull that over, then eventually reach down and pluck a blade of long grass, which I tuck behind one ear. It seems like a more sensible way to test the idea than actually hurting myself. I press my palms against the tree trunk. It also feels strangely cold. I sniff, getting a whiff of earthy pine with something unpleasant underlying it. Something rotten and dead. I wrinkle my nose and back away. That's when I hear it. A loud snort from somewhere to my right. I swing round and catch sight of two narrowed eyes about waist height glaring at me from beyond the gloom, luminous and yellow, shining like distant lamps. They are definitely eyes, though. The pupils are slitted, and as I stare at them, they vanish for an instant as the creature blinks. There's another snort, followed this time by a cloud of misty breath. I start backing away slowly. Unfortunately, the thing watching me doesn't seem to like this idea and moves towards me. Even though I can only make out its eyes, I can hear it moving through the undergrowth. Its feet make hard, clipped sounds on the ground, like hooves. I stop. It stops too. As I click my tongue, encouraging it to come closer, I wonder whose mind conjured this up. I no longer believe I'm the creator of any of these visions. As ridiculous as it seems, I'm confident that what I see is what others dream. I only have a small sample size to go by, but the dreams seem to be dependent on who touched me last. Maybe I'm not in a human's dream this time. Maybe it's the chairman's. I gaze thoughtfully at the gleaming eyes. Is this what a cat would dream about? Very possibly. Here, kitty, I call. If this is Chairman Meow's dream, I want to see him. I crouch down to coax him out from where he is hiding. There's a sudden growl, and the creature suddenly charges forward. It gets close enough for me to see snapping jaws and a shaggy mane before common sense kicks in, and I spin round and sprint. It's not the smartest thing to do. Now I'm making myself look like prey, but the alternative is staying where I am and getting chomped. With no clue as to what sort of beast it is, and therefore no understanding of its speed or stamina, I have to use my wits. I streak left, ignoring the pain as brambles and thorns scratch my bare legs. Then I swing round a tree and change direction. I continue zigzagging, but the creature continues to thunder after me. Secure in the knowledge that I'm safely asleep at home, I don't feel a surge of adrenaline or panic. I remember my damp hair after the first dream and the cut on my cheek after the second, so I want to avoid serious injury if I can. But there's no way this thing could kill me. My mind works calmly through the options. I could climb a tree, but I didn't like the cold feeling of the first one. I could keep zigzagging and wait for the creature to get bored and go in search of another plaything. Surely the chairman's cue to show up would be about now. I'm curious to see what will happen when he does. I'll get an insight into the animal kingdom that no one has ever had before. I feel a frisson of excitement that's slightly tempered by the knowledge that I won't be able to tell anyone the truth about what cats dream. Before I can make a decision, I see something on the forest floor and swerve to avoid it. 3 seconds later, there's an agonized screech and a heavy thump. Although I keep running for several more feet, it doesn't take a genius to work out that I'm no longer being chased. I stop and turn round. There's a dark shape on the ground, thrashing loudly and making an odd high-pitched sound that can only be from pain. Gingerly, I take a few steps forward. The creature is no longer paying me any attention. Its movements are becoming wilder and more frantic. I take another step. It's difficult to be sure because of the writhing, but it looks like some kind of horse. It's not any horse I've ever seen in real life, though. Its coat is black, but I glimpse ruby-red hooves as they kick against the ground. There's something around its head, and I bend down to look more closely. When I work out what it is, I straighten up, then I bend down again just to be sure. It's definitely what I thought it was. A single spiraled horn rising from its forehead, looking both beautiful and deadly. This isn't a horse at all. It's a damned unicorn. I move behind its head so I'm not in danger of getting spiked. The creature is still ignoring me, but its movements are growing less frenetic. I kneel down and gently touch its mane. It jerks away as if frightened, so I try again. The unicorn huffs. There, boy, I soothe. It snarls, and I almost fall backwards. Its muzzle twists towards me, and its jaws open to reveal a row of sharp white molars that look as if they've been chiselled into points. It wouldn't be much fun to be bitten by those. There, girl, I try. The unicorn relaxes a little. From the way its gums keeps drawing back over its teeth, it's still keen to take a chunk out of me, but it's in pain, and that is keeping it at bay. I reach out again for its mane, more boldly this time, and stroke it several times. Each touch calms it down, until it stops whining and writhing. Its breathing is heavy and laboured, and its yellow eyes are half closed. I take advantage of the situation and try to work out what's wrong. When it moves its legs slightly, I see the trap. Steel jaws encase the unicorn's forelock, and blood is seeping from the wickedly serrated edges. Poor thing, I say softly. It lets out a whimper in response. I'm going to have a look at your leg, I tell it. It would be nice if you didn't try to eat me or kick me. I know I'm no virgin, so there'll be no laying of your pretty head in my lap, but that doesn't mean I'm suitable as a midnight snack, okay? The unicorn flicks its tail. Taking that as tacit agreement, I step round its supine body and kneel down by the trap. It's a lethal-looking thing. I chew my lip. I don't want to make things worse by trying to remove it, but I can't leave the poor animal like this, whether it's a dream unicorn with a dream wound or not. I grip my teeth and touch the jaws of the trap. The unicorn screeches. I barely brushed it, I say, exasperated. If you want me to help you, you're going to have to quieten down. I can't do with all the screaming. I look it in the eyes. It blinks at me, and I'm sure I see a flicker of resigned acceptance. I nod briskly. Now, this is going to hurt a lot, but once the trap's off, you'll feel a whole lot better. I'm going to do this on the count of three. I grip both sides of the encircling trap. One. Two. Without waiting for three, I jerk as forcefully as I can manage and yank the steel jaws apart. The unicorn screeches again, but manages to pull away, freeing its leg. It lies there panting for a moment or two, then staggers up. I snap the trap shut again to prevent any other creatures getting caught in it and toss it to the side. I frown at the unicorn's wound and look upwards. Now it's upright and I can see it clearly. I realise it's really not that big, more the size of a small pony than a horse. I need to clean your wound, I tell it.
Is there a stream or a river or something nearby? The unicorn snickers, dropping its head. It nuzzles my hair for a brief moment, then draws back. I start getting back to my feet, just as it turns and darts away.
Hey!
I yell, as it is swallowed up into the darkness again.
Your leg will get infected! Come back!
Silence. I curse and dust my palms against my t-shirt. Infected, I scoff. Zoe, it's not real. I roll my eyes at myself. Out of all of the weird dreams I've had so far, this is by far the strangest. If I'm expecting the chairman to show up or for me to wake up, I'm disappointed. I'm still in the dream forest and I'm still bloody cold. There's not even a distant whinny from the departed unicorn. Unsure what to do, I start walking in the direction it disappeared in. Perhaps I'll come across something else. There's no discernible path, so I have to pick my way through, ducking under low-lying branches and making sure I don't collide with trees that seem to spring up out of nowhere. I pay close attention to the ground in case there are any more traps. I start to enjoy the walk and start paying attention to the different plants I can see. Most of them seem like the ones you find in any countryside woodland. Occasionally, however, there's one that appears mutated and different. For example, I spot a tiny snowdrop at the foot of an oak tree, but when I bend down to take a closer look, I see that the stamen inside is blood red. The shade is not dissimilar to the hooves of the unicorn. I have no idea how much time has passed when I spot the glow of a fire ahead. I can smell the sweet smoke drifting towards me through the trees. I'm tempted to avoid the area altogether and continue with my quiet inspection of the flora. But as this is the first break in the dream landscape, I feel compelled to check it out. I stride confidently towards the fire, slowing only when I get close and hear muffled voices. There are two of them, both male, although the first one is more rough and gravelly.
The mayor has his damn clothes and everything, he complains.
You could challenge him.
And risk all-out civil war.
There's a derisive snort.
Hardly. Even if we succeeded, who would replace him? Certainly not me. Besides, almost everyone believes in the mayor. There's so much damned hero worship going on that he could murder someone in the middle of the damned square and people will still believe he's a good guy.
You need to do something. The department's getting too powerful.
My eyes widen. The department? Whose dream am I in then? Is it the old man's? How can he still be dreaming if he's already passed away? I draw as close as I dare, realising I'm on the edge of a small clearing. I peer out from under a heavy leaf-lined branch. The man nearest to me is sitting on a log. His clothes remind me of a cowboy's, a blue plaid shirt, boots and worn jeans. He has a tanned and weathered face, and I place him in his mid-40s. I study his companion. Until now, he's had his back to me, but he half turns so his features are silhouetted against the flickering fire. There's something dark and predatory about him that makes me shiver. He has long dark hair, which curls just above his shoulders, and there's an aquiline cast to his face. Even through the shadows falling against his cheek, I can make out a curving scar. He screams danger.
Well, says the cowboy, you should think about it. I know a few others are working against him, but they're never going to get anywhere. You have a shot. Everyone hates me. He's made sure of that. I don't hate you. People will realise the truth about the mayor sooner or later. But if it's later...
His voice trails off.
Think about it. Anyway, it's time I was going. I have an early start tomorrow. Believe me, his dark friend growls. It's all I've been thinking about.
The cowboy doffs an imaginary hat and glances up at the sky. I follow his gaze, seeing nothing more than black night. When I look down again, he's vanished. I gasp as a steel grip encircles my wrist and drags me out. I try to pull away, but the dark man who's grabbed me is far too strong.
Who the hell are you? He demands. Did the mayor send you?
I don't know who that is. He shakes me.
Don't play dumb.
A sudden rush of anger possesses me. Dumb? You prick. Stupid dream man. I slam my free hand into his chest, briefly registering rock-hard muscle. He narrows his grey eyes at me, glancing up and down my body. I feel oddly naked and vulnerable, but I refuse to let him see it.
You're an outlier, he says in disgust, releasing his grip.
I back away, rubbing my wrist.
No, I'm not. What's that, anyway?
He sighs.
Just pinch yourself. You'll wake up quickly enough.
I pause. You know this is a dream.
As you do, so it seems.
He steps backwards and eyes me speculatively.
Have you been here before?
No, I answer wearily. Where is here? His body relaxes.
Never mind, he dismisses. You don't belong here, so toddle off back to where you came from. Give yourself a pinch and you'll wake up safe in your bed. You'll forget any of this ever happened.
I fold my arms and glare at him. I really don't like him.
Actually, I announce, I think I might stick around here for a while.
He circles round me.
If you don't do it, I'll have to do it for you.
Don't you dare touch me, I hiss.
You're quite spiky, aren't you?
I don't like the way this is going at all. I'm just about to march away when he lunges towards me, nipping the skin on my arm between his finger and his thumb.
Ouch! That hurt!
He stares at me.
You're still here.
Well, of course I'm still here. You can't make me leave.
Actually, I have no idea whether that's true or not, but it sounds good. This guy is starting to really piss me off. 3 nights, 3 dreams, and 3 men, and none of them have been anyone I'd want to dream about.
In fact, I begin, you can go and...
He spins round before I can finish my sentence, thrusting me behind him.
What are you doing?
His shoulders are broad, and when I try to move to the side, he pushes me back again.
Be quiet, he hisses. No, I will not damn well be quiet. You can't tell me what to do. You probably don't even exist.
Fine. It's not like it'll really hurt you anyway.
What won't really hurt me?
He steps to the side, and I see what he's talking about. Standing at the far edge of the clearing and watching us with her shining yellow eyes is the unicorn.
You came back. I turn to the man. Do you have any water? She's been hurt.
He looks at me, stunned. I roll my eyes.
Never mind.
I walk towards the waiting unicorn.
How's your leg? Does it still hurt?
The unicorn whinnies in response. I crouch down to check the wound. It stopped bleeding and doesn't seem as deep as I thought. I reach up and pat her muzzle.
Good girl.
Who are you?
The man says. I ignore him, keeping my attention on the animal. Her coat is remarkably soft.
Who?
He repeats through gritted teeth.
Are you?
I turn my head round and give him a brilliant smile.
I'm Zoe, of course.
I cock my head.
Do you hear that?
He takes a step forward and the unicorn growls. I wouldn't have thought a horse-like creature would be capable of that kind of sound. The noise gets louder.
It's like ringing.
I frown. The man opens his mouth to speak, but then I'm back in my bed, blinking up at the ceiling while the phone shrieks next to me. My eyes are bleary, but my skin is tingling all over. I shake myself, trying to regain consciousness, and grab hold of the receiver.
Hello?
I mumble.
It's Rollins, the policewoman says. How did you know?
I rub my eyes, completely confused.
How did I know what?
About the letters.
For a moment, I don't have the faintest idea what she's referring to. Then I sit bolt upright.
The postman! You checked him out. I thought you were too busy.
I had a spare half an hour.
Her voice is gruff.
Tell me how you knew.
He was hoarding mail.
He was. We found boxes of it in a room in his home. He must have been at it for years.
I think quickly.
Some of my letters went missing, ones that I should have received, and there were a few things he said. He looked scared when you came round the other day.
When?
For the statement. You passed him on the path.
I didn't really notice him, she says, half to herself.
Well, I prevaricate. I just put 2 and 2 together. I'm glad I didn't waste your time.
We'll probably need you to make another statement.
No problem.
The chairman jumps up onto the bed and I scratch his ears. That jogs my memory and I reach up to where I tuck the blade of grass behind my ear. There's nothing there. Of course not. I might be able to tap into others' unconscious selves, but what I experience are still just dreams. They're not real.
You're having a busy week, Miss Lydon,
Rollins comments. I raise my eyebrows to myself in mild amusement. She really has no idea just how busy it's been.
Chapter 5. Dreams are true while they last, and do we not live in dreams? Alfred Lord Tennyson.
It may be the weekend, but given the events of the last few days and my self-absorption, I feel compelled to catch up on work after Rollins and Hartman leave. My neighbours must think I'm a criminal, considering how many times they've been round in the past couple of days. Hartman spent most of the visit eyeing me suspiciously, and I knew he was desperate to ask me how I knew his pet name. I kept my attention on Rollins, however, and my answers were short and to the point, even if not entirely truthful. I wasn't concerned about having the two police officers inside my home, nor was I bothered about being evasive when I answered their questions. For the first time I can remember, my mind keeps drifting away from the bytes and numbers on the screen to what's going on inside my head whenever I fall asleep. If my lack of fear is a cause for celebration, my lack of focus is disturbing. Of course, that may be because my feet and legs are stinging from cuts and scratches. Every so often I stop and marvel at them. How is it even possible? I'm so distracted that I completely forget my mother is due to visit. When the doorbell rings, I half leap out of my chair. My heart thuds. But a few seconds later, I feel calmer. I purse my lips and walk to the door, unbolting it.
Afternoon, Zoe!
She bustles in, reaching over to hug me. I draw away before she can succeed. I'd made a point earlier of shaking Rollins' hand when she left. Having decided that last night had nothing to do with the chairman after all, and with no desire to return to the wood, there was little choice but to touch someone and gain entrance to their head instead. However, I most definitely do not want to see what's rattling inside my mother's brain. That would be an extraordinary invasion of privacy. I apologise when she looks hurt.
I think I'm coming down with a cold. There's no point in you catching it too.
She frowns at me.
How on earth can you catch the cold? You never go anywhere to come in contact with germs.
I shrug. Maybe the chairman brought the virus in, or the police.
She is staring at me. I suddenly realise she has no idea what happened with the old man, and quickly I tell her, attempting to play the incident down. Considering he died in my hallway, however, that's almost impossible.
And they still don't know who he was?
I shake my head.
Nope.
Zoe, that's awful. Why did it happen to you, of all people?
That's what I'd like to know. I glance away awkwardly.
Bad luck, I guess, I mumble.
Your neighbours should have called me. I've told them all several times.
Mother, I'm aghast. I'm not a child.
She throws me a look.
And what would you do in my position?
I grumble under my breath and change the subject. There's no point arguing against the stony face and stalwart heart of a mother hen.
How was Bridge?
The Joneses were cheating.
I raise my eyebrows.
Really?
Of course.
I brew a pot of tea while she explains in great detail. Normally I'd hang on every word, but my mind keeps wandering back to the forest and the strange dark man with more muscles than manners.
Zoe, are you listening?
She asks finally.
Yes.
A beat later, I'm contrite.
No, sorry.
My mother sighs, reaching out to ruffle my hair. I pull away just in time, and exasperation crosses her face. I offer her a tight smile.
Mum, when I was little, did I have many bad dreams?
She freezes, her mug halfway to her mouth.
Why, have you been having nightmares?
I make a quick denial, but still force the issue.
Did I?
There were a few.
She picks at her nail polish. My mother takes great pride in her appearance. She only starts destroying her manicure when she's feeling stressed.
But lots of children have night terrors, and they went away eventually.
Night terrors? She sighs.
When you were about 4 or 5, there was a period of about 6 months when you woke up screaming every night.
I swallow.
Really? I don't remember at all.
You were very young. It's not surprising.
Did I...
I pause, choosing my words carefully.
Did I ever say what I'd been dreaming about?
Do we have to talk about this now? It was all a very long time ago, darling.
Please, I'm just curious. I have a feeling my face betrays my desperation.
A birdman with a moustache.
Birdman?
That's what you used to say. Now, where's that cat of yours? She stands up.
I ignore her attempts to change the subject.
How did the dream stop?
They just did.
You got older. You no longer needed a nightlight.
Her eyes shift, and I know she's being as evasive with me as I was with the police.
Mum?
Goodness, is that the time? I must be off. She scoops up her belongings and makes a beeline for the door, scrambling to unfasten the locks. Her fingers fumble and she curses.
I'll do it.
I move past her. Unfortunately, as I do, my arm brushes past hers and I flinch. Bugger it.
What's wrong, darling?
I might ask you the same question, I answer, still annoyed with myself.
You're in a hurry to leave?
I have a lot to do. I'm sorry. I'd love to stay longer.
I unlock the door and turn to her.
It seems like you're trying to avoid answering my questions. She trills out a high-pitched laugh.
Don't be silly, Zoe. I'll call you later and see how you are.
She looks at the carpet.
Is that where the man...
I nod, and my mother shivers.
He should have had the consideration to die in his own home.
Sorry, darling, but you've been through enough trauma as it is. She kisses me on the cheek, and this time I let her. After all, the damage has already been done. She leaves in a whirl of flying scarves and Chanel No. 5. I watch her go, lost in thought. Once she's out of sight, I rebolt all the locks and go and sit down. I fight sleep for as long as I can. Unfortunately, by the time midnight rolls around, I'm so tired that I know it's a losing battle. I fall into bed, fully dressed this time, and close my eyes. For a moment, nothing happens, and I think I might escape, but just when I start to relax, my ears prickle again. It's the same forest. I really, really don't want to come across that man again. Neither have I any desire to be chased by imaginary unicorns and cause them to be caught in the steel jaws of vicious man-traps. So I take a gamble and walk in the opposite direction to the previous night, hoping no glowing eyes will suddenly appear. At least now that I'm clothed, it's not as damn cold as it was before. I tramp through the dry brush. I pay less attention to what's around me this time. I'm more concerned with finding a way out of this bloody place. I move faster, but the density of trees and undergrowth, not to mention the darkness, means I'm still not as fast as I wish. I march on and on for what seems like an age. I remember my glee from the first night with Hartman and sigh. These hallucinations are no longer any fun. I'm not scared exactly, but I feel desperation seeping into my soul. When several tree roots hamper my progress even more, my frustration boils over.
This is freaking stupid!
I kick at one and only succeed in hurting my toe.
There's no reason to take it out on the oak,
a slow musical voice says. I spin round. I can't see a damn thing.
Would you like some help in getting out of here?
I hesitate. Then I stop acting like a wimp and square my shoulders. None of this is real, Zoe, I remind myself.
Yes, I say aloud.
Excellent. I do so enjoy helping out those in need.
There's an edge to the words that makes me suspicious. Before I can form the thought properly, however, a woman appears. She has jet black hair and alabaster skin that looks as pure and smooth as a newborn baby's. I think of my own scratched legs and freckled arms and feel very flawed. But she's a dream woman. Of course she looks perfect, just like that man from last night looked perfect. Like an airbrushed magazine picture, I mutter. The woman arches an eyebrow.
A what?
Never mind. How do I get out of here? She laughs.
Come, come. There's no need to be so hasty. After all, we've not been properly introduced yet. I'm Lilith.
She shakes her hair and it flies up in a soft halo, framing her face and mirroring the dark of the forest.
I'm Zoe.
I shake my hair. It slaps me uncomfortably on the cheek before falling limply back down.
Oh well. And where are you from, Zoe?
The keen interest in her gaze is making me more wary.
The Quiet Lands, I say.
Lilith seems confused.
The Quiet Lands? I have not heard of this place.
Where are you from?
She smiles, revealing a row of even white teeth. Here, of course. And where is here? Lilith's smile grows wider and an icy finger trails down my spine. This doesn't feel right. I back away.
This is your first time here? She asks.
No, I burst out. It's not. I've been here before.
Have you indeed? So why are you lost?
I glare at her. Lilith is not as helpful as advertised. Screw it. I don't need her. Even if I spend the rest of the night wandering around, I'll still wake up safe in my bed. Never mind, I sniff. I'll find my own way out. I start to sidle past her, but she grabs my arm. But as soon as she touches me, she pulls away as if burned. Her fingers leave an imprint on my skin. She snarls, her perfect features growing twisted and ugly.
What are you?
I'm Zoe. I try to move past her again, but she blocks my path.
Did the department send you?
I stop.
The department? What is the department?
Evil, she hisses. There's so much venom in her tone that I step backwards.
But
I'm interrupted by a sudden long howl. I blink.
What the hell was that?
Lilith's features smooth over, as if someone's taken an eraser and wiped them clean.
I must go.
She regards me with a mixture of fear and anticipation.
I will see you again, Zoe from the Quiet Lands.
Before I can open my mouth, Lilith vanishes. Well, that was a waste of bloody time, I mutter. I step carefully over the tree roots, but I still stumble. My body flies forward and the ground rushes up towards me. I brace my hands to break the fall, but my ribs smash hard against the ground, and then hands are helping me to my feet, and I'm blinking in brilliant sunshine. I look up. My rescuer looks like the all-American hero, with his blonde hair, friendly blue eyes, chiseled jaw and glowing tan. My cheeks suddenly feel warm.
I shouldn't be allowed to blush in a dream, I say aloud, then clamp my hand over my mouth.
He looks at me curiously.
You know you're in a dream.
I frown. The dark, annoying man said something similar.
Yes, I say slowly, as the heat in my face subsides. Where am I exactly?
He steps aside, throwing out his arm with a dramatic flourish towards the scenery behind him. I see a pretty village with cobbled streets, buildings that look as if they were built several centuries before, several people milling around and overlooking everything, a fairy tale castle that would turn Walt Disney green with envy. I gape.
Welcome to the Dreamlands,
he says.
I'm Bronn.
Bronn leads me through several winding streets. Some of the people we pass give me curious glances, others ignore me. Given the quaint surroundings, I might have expected everyone to be wearing period dress, but most of them are dressed like anyone you'd see on the pavements of London. I spy a Metallica t-shirt, a few bohemian dresses, and even a onesie. Bronn is rather dapper, in an open-neck shirt and grey trousers. I'm grateful that I'm not wearing my scruffy old t-shirt. He might not be real, but that doesn't mean I don't want to impress him. We stop at the door of a small pub with a thatched roof. Bronn grins and bows, opening the door for me like a gentleman. I try not to simper and step inside. Everyone turns towards us. The bartender, polishing a glass, raises his eyebrows. Ignoring my discomfort at being the centre of attention, I let Bronn lead me to a small corner table.
What would you like to drink?
I spot a man nearby with a pint of amber liquid topped with a frothy head. I'll have one of those. It's not like I get to drink draft beer in the real world anymore.
A lady after my own heart,
Bronn says with a smile, and goes to order. I look around the room more carefully. The gentleman next to me with the pint is in deep conversation with a woman. I catch a few words, but none of it makes sense. My eyes drift over to a group of boisterous teenagers who are surely too young to drink legally. They are punching each other in the arm, shouting and laughing. I smile. It's almost like being normal again. Bronn turns round and waves at me from the bar, and I wave back. Then, from the corner of the room, I see a pair of glowering silver eyes. I stiffen. It's the dark man from the forest. If looks could kill, I'd be a rotting corpse on the floor. He gives every impression of wanting to throttle me.
What the hell? It's only another dream, I tell myself. I wave in his direction, and he looks even crosser. I notice all the tables around him are empty, and several of the other customers are sneaking glances at him. He wasn't wrong before. People really do dislike him.
There you go,
Bron says cheerfully, placing a pint in front of me. I pick up the glass and take a tentative sip. I can taste it, I crow.
It's good, isn't it?
Mmm. I chug down several mouthfuls. Screw creepy forests. This is the way I want the rest of my dreams to go. A shadow falls across our table, and we both look up. A woman is standing in front of us.
I need to talk to you,
she says. She's obviously talking to Bron, not me. As lovely as Bron is, I'm more than happy to focus on my drink, so I don't care. Bron, however, is less relaxed. He gestures at me.
Ashley, this is...
Zoe, I supply helpfully. I smile and take another sip.
What a beautiful name,
he says. He looks at Ashley.
We should probably do this another time.
Why? Ashley pulls up a chair. She's just an outlier. She won't remember this, and she'll never be here again. She looks at me guiltily. Sorry, I don't mean to be rude. Bron, we need to do something about the mayor's guards. They're getting too heavy-handed. I frown, zoning in on the conversation and Ashley's earlier words. Outlier? I've heard that before. What is it? The pair of them turn to me. Ashley seems astonished, but I swear a look of glee crosses Bron's face.
Where did you hear it before?
Last night. I was in the forest then, too.
You were here yesterday, and now you're here again today.
I nod. Yup, although I've got to say, this place is much nicer than the forest. Ashley and Bron exchange looks.
Zoe,
Bron says urgently.
Who did you meet in the forest?
The dark-haired man in the corner who has a face like thunder. I point to where he was sitting and realise he's gone. I shrug. He has a scar. The pair of them stiffen. You met Dante, Ashley says slowly. I take another swig. Damn, this beer is good. I didn't catch his name. He wasn't very nice. He said I was an outlier and that I should pinch myself and wake up.
Well, he would, wouldn't he?
Bron breathes. There's triumph in his gaze.
I knew this would pay off sooner or later.
I drain the last of my glass and look at him. I don't understand. An outlier is someone who finds their way here by accident, Ashley explains. We get a few every week. Bron takes it upon himself to greet them all, just on the off chance they end up being travellers. I'm even more confused. Travellers? People who can come here at will. I didn't choose to come here, I say. In fact, I was trying to... There's a shout from the table of teenagers. One of the boys is on his feet and raising his fists. The girl opposite him springs up, grabs a glass, and empties its contents. She smashes it against the back of a chair and jabs it in the boy's direction.
Bron,
Ashley says warningly. Irritated, he gets up and strides over. Goodness, I never expected my dreams to have violence in them, I comment as I watch him snatch the broken glass from the girl. I'm conscious of Ashley looking at me. What? I ask. This isn't your dream, Zoe, she says, her voice low. Is it yours? Obviously, I've never met her nor touched her, but it's not as if I've had a large sample on which to test my theories. She looks confused. No, it's not anyone's specific dream. What do you mean? She looks frustrated, and I realise that Bron is heading back in our direction. Look, if you end up here again, come and find me, and I'll explain everything. I'll be by the river. She stands up. I've got to go. I'll talk to you some other time, Bron.
I thought it was important.
It'll keep for now. She throws a tight smile in my direction. Maybe I'll see you around, Zoe. I try to smile back. Maybe. She walks out, and Bron takes her seat.
I'm glad she's gone. Ashley's wonderful, but now I can get to know you better without any interruptions.
I look at his smiling face. I think I'm going to need another drink first, I admit.
Chapter 6. Deep in that darkness, peering, long I stood there, wondering, fearing, doubting. dreaming dreams no mortal ever dared to dream before. Edgar Allan Poe.
When I wake up on Sunday morning, my head is pounding. I can't work out why until I remember that I drank several more pints of beer in the dream. Brom was remarkably good company, but I'm not sure that makes an imaginary hangover any more pleasant to bear. I massage my temples, then recall what Ashley said, and frown. Perhaps it's not an imaginary hangover after all. I pad into the bathroom and throw a couple of paracetamol down my throat. As I'm still wearing the same clothes, which now feel sticky and uncomfortable, I strip off and have a hot shower. If nothing else, it might wake me up and push away the dregs of my headache. When I'm dressed again, I go downstairs, make sure the chairman has enough food, and collect a large piece of paper from my study. I pin it onto the wall. I start with the old man, drawing a small stick figure in the left corner. Next to it, I write electric shock. I draw a line and add in Hartman. After he touched me, I was in his dream, or vice versa. He didn't see me in the dream, though, and had no recollection of my presence. And when I woke up, I had damp hair, as if I really had been there in that alley, standing in the rain. Underneath Hartman, I include the postman and his details. They're remarkably similar to Hartman's, and surely it's not a coincidence that my suspicions about his letter hoarding were true. I frown, then draw another line. 2 nights ago, I had no human contact, but ended up in the forest. I have scratches on my legs to prove it. Last night, however, the last person I touched was my mother, and I ended up in the forest again, followed by the place that Bron called the Dreamlands, where I drank beer. Now, I have a hangover. Obviously, whatever physical experiences I have when I dream manifest themselves into reality. I think about the Dreamlands and the way people there interacted with me in a way that neither Hartman nor the postman had. Lilith aside, the others all seemed to recognise the dream quality. Was it possible that they were experiencing the same thing as me? It does make a kind of sense. It would be beyond belief to imagine I'm unique. The pattern of where I end up when I fall asleep doesn't fit. Maybe I didn't end up in my mother's dream because she was a family member. But why didn't I end up in Rollin's dream? I stand back and examine my diagram thoughtfully. It's a shame I'm not more of an artist. I abandon my chart and turn to the internet, searching for ways to prevent dreams. I scroll through various pages and websites, reading about remedies ranging from chewing mustard seeds to lavender oil on your pillow to hard drugs. Then something catches my eye. I grab the phone and dial. "Mum," I say as soon as she answers, "I need to ask you a quick question." Her voice is sleepy, and I realise it's barely 7 o'clock on a Sunday morning. I must have woken her up. "Zoe, what's wrong?" Damn it, I've worried her now. "Nothing, nothing at all. I just wanted to ask you if you still had the present Aunt Brenda gave you last year."
"Huh?"
"The one she brought back from America, the dream catcher."
"Oh, that thing. Zoe, what on earth is this all about?"
"Do you still have it?" I persist.
"Yes, it's hanging in my window. What's going on?"
"Nothing," I quickly say. "Go back to sleep." I hang up. So maybe dream catchers work after all. I think about Rollins. Phoning up a police officer to ask them if they own a Native American craft piece is definitely weird, but I dig out her number and call.
"This is Sergeant Rollins."
Unlike my mother, she sounds wide awake. At least that's something. "Hi, it's Zoe Lydon."
"What's wrong?"
Nothing. I just... Do you have a dream catcher?"
"What?"
I wince. "You know, one of those circles with the string and the feathers."
"I know what a dream catcher is, Miss Lydon. What I don't know is why you're calling me up first thing in the morning to ask me such a personal question."
"It could be worse. It wasn't like I was asking her to describe her underwear drawer." "Please," I say. "I know it sounds strange, but it's, research I'm conducting for my work. There aren't many people these days who I can ask." Rollins, thankfully, seems to buy my explanation.
"Then the answer is no. I do not own a dream catcher."
Disappointed, I'm about to thank her for her time when she continues,
"I'm not sure how much good one would do me anyway. I rarely see my bed these days."
I freeze. "You're on night shift."
12 till 12,
she says. Yesterday, today and tomorrow. Government cutbacks. I make a noise that hopefully suggests commiseration and hang up. I didn't share my mother's dreams because of the dreamcatcher, and I didn't share Sergeant Rawlins' dreams because she didn't sleep. I swivel round and stare at the diagram. I think I'm starting to understand what's going on, even if I don't have the faintest idea why. I'm desperate to get back to the Dreamlands and find Ashley again. I'm certain she'll provide me with more answers. But thanks to my enforced solitude, I'm no longer as trusting as I used to be. I want to test my theories first before I trust a stranger who may not even be real. So I decide to try and enter another person's dream first and forgo the Dreamlands for a night. I start by ordering in groceries. My fridge and cupboards are fairly full, and I'm aware that deviating from my routine might mean I end up with a different delivery person to the one who usually calls. That does my terror-filled agoraphobia no good, but I swallow my fear and force myself to shake the hand of the spotty kid who eventually shows up with my bags. Once that ordeal is over, I call Interflora. I'm aghast at the prices. I don't even like cut flowers, so I order the cheapest bouquet. When it comes, and I've brushed the hand of the woman who hands them to me, I'm pale and sweating. 3, however, is supposed to be a lucky number, so I call MailQuick to pick up a delivery for Jerry. It's nothing urgent, just some papers that need signing. Once it's done, though, I feel relief rippling through me. The odds of all 3 of my delivery personnel having blocked dreams is too unlikely. I go to bed early, taking a Valium for good measure. Even with the drug, it takes a long time to drop off. When I finally feel the now familiar ear prickle, I smile. Here we go. I'm beside a river. There's no sound, despite the fact that it's extraordinarily wide. In fact, the water doesn't seem to be moving at all. Beyond it is a majestic mountain range, fringed with trees of all hues. There's something oddly flat about it, though, as if I've stepped inside a postcard. It's pretty, but it's not real. I turn to my right. There's a person there whom I immediately recognise as the kid from the supermarket. He's crouching down, throwing fish into the river. It makes little sense until I realise there are several bears there, lined up and waiting their turn. They're not the sort of mountain-dwelling bears you'd expect to see in this kind of landscape. They are all manner of shapes, colours and sizes. I'm sure I can even see a polar bear. All the animals are large and healthy, with glossy coats and shining eyes. I grin. Well, this is almost bearable, I murmur. I stride towards the kid, but he's engrossed in his task. I clear my throat, then speak to him, but he continues tossing fish into the yawning mouths of the animals. I watch for several moments until my attention is caught by the appearance of a small fluffy shape by his side. It's a puppy, with long floppy ears and chocolate brown eyes. It sniffs the basket of fish and wags its tail. The kid reaches down and pats its head, and the puppy groans in delight. I can't help smiling. I'm about to try to attract the puppy's attention when there's a deafening roar. One of the bears has snapped its jaws shut and is staring not at the man, but at the little dog. Its eyes are round and black, and I feel a sense of foreboding. I bend down to pick up the puppy, but my movements are too slow and too sluggish. The bear is already moving. It swoops down more swiftly than I'd have thought possible, grabs the puppy in its mouth, and shakes it from side to side. The dog yelps while I scream in horror. Blood streams from the bear's mouth. The kid stops throwing the fish and freezes as the bear throws the lifeless little corpse to one side. I step back, double over, and retch. When I recover and stand up, the kid has returned to feeding the bears and another puppy is by his side. Or the same puppy. I can't tell because it looks identical. It wags its tail and seems happy, but I can already see the same bear starting to shift its gaze. Taking charge of the situation, I tap the kid on the shoulder. He doesn't turn round, but he does jerk his head towards me. I move round to his other side and tap him again, and he jerks again. I rock back on my heels. He's not conscious that I'm there, but he does feel something which corresponds with what I experienced in my first dream. I snap my fingers in front of his face while the bear licks its lips. The kid blinks. Recalling what the dark man, Dante, told me, I reach his arm and pinch his skin. Suddenly, I'm yanked backwards, as if someone has grabbed the scruff of my neck and is pulling me. I lose my footing and fall over, and then I'm no longer by the river. It's my local town square. I may not have been there for more than 18 months, but I'd recognise it anywhere. The shops are the same, but there's a strange absence of traffic. I get to my feet and look around. The place is completely deserted. A single tumbleweed that would be more at home in a street in Arizona than a little Scottish town blows in my direction, followed by a familiar rattle and whistle, just like you'd hear in the soundtrack to a cowboy film. Alarm bells ring in my head. Slowly backing away, I keep my eyes trained in front of me. A woman pops up at one end. She's wearing a business suit, but she has boots with spurs above her ankles and a gun belt round her hips. Her hands hover above the holsters. I look in the other direction and spot the florist in a similar pose.
It's time, Belinda!
The florist shouts.
You've had your fun, and now you need to face the consequences!
Her Scottish brogue has been supplanted by an American twang.
I ain't no lily-livered yellow whore!
The other woman calls back. Her fingers twitch. I wonder whether I should interrupt them. If this is like the other dreams, they won't see or hear me, but I might be able to distract them. I picture the dead puppy. The last thing I want is to see this pair blast each other into oblivion, even if they're not real.
You stole my horse!
The florist yells.
Draw!
Before I can react, they both lunge for their weapons and fire. Dust rises from the ground as shots echo around the empty street. I cover my ears and duck. The noise seems to go on for an eternity. When silence finally returns and I peek out to see what's happening, Belinda is standing over the florist. I run up to her. She nudges her fallen victim with her toe.
He's a no good hoss. He ain't worth dying for. But dying's what you're doing.
The florist chokes, blood gurgling up from her mouth. Her skin is the colour of chalk.
He's all I got,
she croaks. Her eyes roll back, and yet again, I feel myself being dragged violently away by a force I cannot control. The final dream is the worst. I'm surrounded by thick fog that tastes sulfuric. I can hear someone, I assume it's the mail quick worker, calling out for help and stumbling around. No matter how hard I try, I can't reach him. I search blindly, doing what I can to stay calm. The more he shouts, the more my panic grows.
Hold on!
I cry hoarsely.
I'll come and get you!
It's no good, of course. He doesn't hear me and doesn't stop. I start to run. My lungs burn and my eyes stream and sting. I don't want to be here, but I don't think I can get out, not until the dream ends naturally or I find Mr. Mailquick and pinch him. Bile rises in my throat as I realise how foolish it was to stumble into someone else's head with no idea of what I might find there. The other two dreams had a surreal quality. This is different. Eventually, I hunker down and hug my knees as tightly as I can, rocking for comfort. And when I wake up, my clothes and my hair stink of the smothering mist. My cheeks are wet with tears. My limbs are stiff and painful, and I am trembling. It's the first time in any of these dreams that I felt genuinely afraid. I'm already trapped in my house. I don't want to be trapped in my own head, too. One of the more positive results of my condition, at least as far as today is concerned, is that I have a mountain of cards and leaflets from local doctors, psychiatrists, psychologists and trauma experts. Almost all of them have been donated by my mother, but a few have been passed on by friends. I study them carefully before selecting one who lists sleep disorders as a speciality. Dr. Miller. I remember he made some home visits during the early days. At the time, he struck me as efficient and capable, even if his therapy didn't do me a scrap of good. I phone him.
I've been having trouble sleeping,
I tell him once I've reintroduced myself and given him time to locate my sparse file.
Insomnia?
He asks.
More like dreams. Bad dreams.
Has this happened before?
I wrap a strand of my hair around my little finger.
It's only a recent thing.
Then it's good,
he tells me confidently.
It means your mind is trying to heal itself. Our daily lives often manifest themselves through dreams. It's a way for your subconscious to work through problems.
There were bears. In the dreams, I mean. I was trying to feed them. It's only a small white lie.
Were you succeeding?
He sounds eager. Yeah, I guess.
That proves you're starting to win. You're learning to handle your problem. This is a fantastic step forward, Zoe.
I murmur noncommittally. One of them killed a puppy.
Oh.
He pauses.
Do you like dogs?
I do, I say it quietly. There was another dream after that when I was lost in some kind of fog. I couldn't get out no matter what I did. It was pretty frightening.
Dreams often are.
He lays on the reassurance.
But the best thing about them is that you're safely wrapped up in your bed.
The thing is that when I dream, I swallow hard, it seems like I'm in control, that I'm aware of what's going on.
Ah, that's interesting. Onironautics.
What?
Onironautics, he repeats. Or rather, lucid dreaming. It's more common than you'd think.
I'm flabbergasted. It exists. Of course.
You're aware you're dreaming.
Yes.
Aware of your own identity.
Yes.
Aware you can make your own decisions within the dream.
Yes.
They are all classic signs. It's all related to the dorsolateral prefrontal cortex. There have been numerous studies on it.
I sink down into the chair. I hadn't expected to have my condition explained to me. It's not real, I whisper. Then I think of the physical evidence afterwards, and doubt returns. What if I dreamt it was raining, and I woke up with wet hair? I ask. There's a short pause.
Well, that's fascinating. Sleepwalking combined with lucid dreaming.
You think I just sleepwalked?
Well, he laughs, what else could it be?
What else indeed? Suddenly I feel an idiot for thinking otherwise. How do I stop it?
That's a different proposition. Dreams cannot be stopped per se. I can send you a prescription for something that might dull your senses, however, and prevent the lucidity from recurring.
Please. I stare at my drawing, my eyes drifting from one scrawled line to another. I snatch it off the wall and screw it up.
Chapter 7. Security is mostly a superstition. Helen Keller.
Naturally, I take great pains this time not to touch the delivery person. The second I have the prescription in my sweaty palms, I slam the door shut and swallow the pills. I won't deny I'm still nervous about what will happen when I sleep, but I feel more at ease. Chemical mind control. You can't beat it. Except on those occasions when it doesn't work. I'm back in the damn Dreamlands forest. Surprisingly, however, I'm not upset or scared. If anything, I'm rather floaty. I reach out and scrape my fingertips across the cold bark of the trees on either side of me and hum. Then I sit down cross-legged. I hold up one hand in front of my face and wiggle my fingers. My vision blurs and I giggle. There's a soft whinny. A moment later, something damp nuzzles my neck. Hello, my unicorn chum. I coo. I frown and deepen my voice. I hereby christen you Pegasus. You may not have wings, but I think I can fly enough for the pair of us. Pegasus huffs and nudges my arm. I ignore her and lie on my back, staring up at the leaves and branches. They stretch down towards me like spindly arms. Witch's arms. It's not real, I say aloud. None of this is real. Pegasus gives a high-pitched screech that could probably be heard for miles, but I barely register it. I don't even look up when her hooves clatter on the hard ground and she twists away, thundering into the trees behind.
What are you doing?
It's a male voice, and filled with derision. I smile. I'm dreaming, of course. What are you doing? There's a muttered curse, and a hand grips my arm, pulling me to my feet. Hey! I protest. I was comfortable there.
Until you freeze to death?
I blink, trying to focus on the silver eyes. Dante, why? My duvet is warm and snuggly. I won't freeze.
Your skin is like ice, and you certainly can freeze.
I wrinkle my nose. I don't like you, I told him. You're stupid. He glowers. Again.
You're drunk.
No, I'm not. I wobble slightly and almost fall. He grips me tighter.
Yes, you are.
No, I'm not.
Yes, you...
He pauses, shakes his head.
This is ridiculous. Who are you?
I told you.
I sniff.
I'm Zoe, and I'm not drunk. I just took a few pills.
He frowns. What kind of pills?
I yank my arms away from him and stumble. Not telling. Now go away. I command you to leave.
There's a flicker of amusement in his face. He rocks back on his heels and folds his arms. I try not to notice how his t-shirt strains against his biceps.
You command me?
An aeronautics,
I say confidently. That's lucid dreaming.
I know what an aeronautics is.
Well, I'm dreaming lucidly, so I'm in control, and I'm telling you to leave.
He licks his lips.
You still think this is just a dream?
No, I say sarcastically. I think I'm in a real forest with a real man, that I just closed my eyes and... I snap my fingers. Poof! I'm here. I'm crazy, I say confidentially. But I'm not that crazy. My doctor said so.
Your doctor, whoever he is, doesn't have a bloody clue.
He leans towards me.
How many times have you been here, Zoe?
I hold up my fingers. They blur and I waggle them. Unfortunately, the movement makes them blur even more, so I drop my hand.
3 times, Dante.
How do you know my name?
Bron told me. He's very good looking, I slur, but he's not real either.
Dante scowls. I can assure you, he says tightly, he's as real as you are.
I squeeze my eyes shut and count to 10. When I open them again, he's still there. The amusement in his face deepens.
You're still here.
My disappointment is clear.
Yes.
He raises an eyebrow.
That's because this is real.
This is a dream. Dreams aren't real.
He snorts. Of course they are, especially if you're a traveller.
I'm not a traveller. I don't go anywhere.
At his sceptical glance, I protest. It's true. I really don't.
It's not like getting on a plane, he says derisively. It's your mind.
I really am crazy,
I say mournfully.
He watches me steadily, and I get the oddest sensation that he's looking right into my soul.
No, he says finally. You're not. You're just one of the few who can tap into their subconscious. What doesn't make sense is why it's not happened before.
I think, I declare, that what doesn't make sense is why you used to work for the mayor.
Dante stiffens.
Who told you that?
I shrug.
Does it matter?
From far in the distance, there's a whinny. I brighten.
Pegasus!
I turn to go in search of my unicorn friend. Anything's better than Dante's knowing sneer. He pulls me back against his chest.
Don't be an idiot.
That unicorn is friendlier than you are,
I mutter.
It's not a damned unicorn. It's a mare.
I try to pull away.
Mares don't have horns.
Not a mare as in a horse. A mare as in nightmare.
Now who's the crazy one?
He sighs.
I'll prove it. Come on.
He releases me and takes a few steps before looking back.
Follow,
he snaps. I want to tell him to sod off, but curiosity gets the better of me, so I trail after him. Unfortunately, he's far more used to the forest than I am, and soon he's pulled away. I quicken my step, struggling to keep up. Dante's muscular form is swallowed up by the darkness, so I have to listen for his footfalls, but he pads as quietly as a cat, and soon I can't hear him. I focus on the ground. There's a trail in the dry bracken, not much more than a few snapped twigs, but enough for me to follow. I'm so focused on my feet, however, that I don't notice when he's stopped, and I collide with his hard body. He frowns angrily, and I only just manage not to stick my tongue out at him.
There's nothing there,
I tell him defiantly, as I sway from side to side and look around.
Wait.
I hiccup in response.
Whatever those damn pills were, he growls, you shouldn't take them.
I agree. My stomach is roiling nauseously, and I'm tired of my blurry vision. But I don't want to give him the satisfaction of being right, so I merely harumph.
I'm serious, he says. It's dangerous to be out here in the forest and not in full possession of your faculties.
It's only a bloody dream.
Shh!
I open my mouth to make a sarky response, but a sudden moan stops me. I grab hold of Dante's arm.
What the hell is that?
I told you to be quiet.
Stop treating me like a child, I hiss.
Stop acting like one. It's an outlier. They're heading this way and there's a mare tracking them. You need to stay silent and out of sight.
Something about the tone of his voice makes me do as he says. I peer into the darkness, trying to pierce the dark shadows. Then I stumble. Dante stiffens in annoyance and pulls me towards him again.
You're still freezing, he mutters.
He wraps his arms round me, and I feel a shiver of delicious warmth. Then the figure appears. I gape. It's an older man, wearing a pair of fraying boxer shorts decorated with red love hearts.
He's wearing underwear, I whisper. He's not cold.
Because he's not here like we are, Dante breathes in my ear. Now be quiet and watch.
I force myself to relax. Normally, if I were in such close contact with someone I didn't know, I'd be hyperventilating and close to passing out. Instead, I find I'm enjoying the sensation of Dante.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.